Strazwice e de Bro Pazalowicz. Na to ne žili jar skazavioa, aeroportes bogatoi dolgoi istori, eto varota v stolicu zlavnoi matushki rashi. Okay, now that we can all agree that I've completely butchered the Russian language, let's take a closer look at the one and only Moscow Airport. If you're from the Western world, you'd probably be forgiven for knowing very little about Moscow. Unlike large ports in the West, Moscow doesn't have a large media presence in the English-speaking world. If you are Eastern European, however, and you still don't know much about Moscow, well, maybe you should listen to your mum and actually get out of the house a little more often. Moscow's Sheremetyevo International Airport sits 30 kilometers north of Moscow CBD. It's one of five international airports in Moscow, but being the closest to the city, Sheremetyevo is the primary port of entry into Moscow. The aerodrome originally began as a military airfield in 1957 during the Cold War era. In September of 1953, a decree was issued by the Soviet Union's Council of Ministers for the construction of the central aerodrome of the Air Force. After 4 years of swift and decisive construction, the airfield was opened for operations in November of 1957 on the same day as Russia celebrated the 40th anniversary of the mighty October Revolution. The first aircraft to land at the airfield were 18 long-haul strategic Tu-95 bombers that were taking part in the 40th anniversary parade. The airfield housed a single paved runway, storage facilities for military ordnance, a large pipeline, and a large bridge was also built across the Klyazma River to better connect the airfield to Moscow's infrastructure. Knowing that the airfield would likely eventually be converted into a civilian airfield, earthworks were also completed in preparation for a future second paved runway, as well as the preparation of the foundations for a command and control center. 2 years later, in 1959, the State Project Institute known as Aeroproct was tasked with designing a functional, efficient, and epic-looking civilian airport that would then be built on the Sheremetyevo site. The ensuing development program consisted of two parts divided into two sectors. Sector 1, the northern part, included aircraft maintenance hangars, freight warehouses, storage facilities, a boiler room, technical facilities, and residential buildings such as canteens, laundromats, and of course the most essential building to the lifestyle of the Soviet Russian citizen, the sauna. Sector 2 to the south consisted of the concourse and the aerodrome building intended for government transportation, a technical facility, and several other auxiliary buildings and facilities. Then on July 30th of 1959, the certificate of delivery and acceptance was signed. This essentially meant that the military had officially transferred the aerodrome to its new civilian operators. A month and a half later, in August of 1959, the first passenger aircraft, a Tu-104B from Leningrad, landed at the new Sheremetyevo civilian airport carrying 100 passengers and 2.5 metric tons of cargo. Then in June of 1960, Sheremetyevo released its first ever international flight from Moscow to Schofield in Berlin, Germany, marking the beginning of a long and uninterrupted reign as Moscow's primary international airport and the gateway into the capital of Russia. The very next day, an opening ceremony was held to make it official. In July of 1962, Russia's flagship airline Aeroflot began its longest route to date, flying from Sheremetyevo to Havana in Cuba and back. Wait, hold up. When was the Cuban Missile Crisis again? October of 1962. A crisis that saw the US and Soviet Empire clash over nuclear missiles on Cuban soil. Actually, you know what? Never mind. Russia is not a country you want to piss off. So for the purpose of this video, let's just say that there is no correlation there at all. Anyway, then in September of 1964, Terminal 1 was completed and opened with the goal of being a purpose-built international terminal. It was called Sheremetyevo 1, original, and was nicknamed the Shot Glass. Okay, now that actually is original. It actually looks pretty cool, to be fair. Sheremetyevo then rounded out the 60s by becoming the primary base of operations for the national carrier Aeroflot. Of Aeroflot's 47 countries that it flew to, almost all of them departed from Sheremetyevo. As of 1969, the airport handled 1.5 million passengers a year, as well as 22,000 tons of freight. Then in 1972, the aerodrome's traffic levels reached a figure large enough to finally justify the construction of the second runway that had long since been prepared for. Built to a length of 3,700 meters, the new concrete runway also came with comprehensive updates to the entire airport's taxiways. 2 years later, in 1974, the second runway was opened for operations, and literally within 2 weeks of its opening, a very obvious bottleneck was discovered that rendered the second runway essentially redundant. You see, both Sheremetyevo's runways were connected by the same central taxi apron, limiting the use of the second runway and capping any form of significant traffic increase. The Council of Ministers were not impressed with Aeroprox for not noticing such a critical flaw. As a result, construction works were expedited, which meant almost every worker at the development site pulling double shifts for 2 years straight before the issue was resolved with the completion of 4 new taxiways, finally allowing air traffic capacity to more than double when dual runway operations resumed in 1977. Around the same time that the runway was reopened, works began on a brand new second terminal that, true to form, would be called Sheremetyevo 2. The master plan for the new terminal spoke of a design that was heavily moulded by regulations surrounding foreign trade in order to diversify the forms of air traffic entering Sheremetyevo once the terminal was built. A contractor named the Berlin Consult was selected for the project, but interestingly, this decision was made in the height of the division between East and West Germany. Due to enormous disagreements with the East German contractor, the contract for the new terminal was reassigned to a West German firm named Reutebau in May of 1977. Then in 1980, Moscow hosted the Olympic Games. So in order to capitalize on the influx of traffic in line with the Games, Sheremetyevo 2 was officially opened for operations at the beginning of the same month that the Games began. Now, the 90s didn't see too many developments take place aside from the resurfacing of Runway 1 in 1997 and an aviation business facility that served as a port of entry and exit for unique forms of aviation such as medical transport, business charters and private recreational aviation. For Sheremetyevo, the major plot point of the 1990s occurred following the events of December the 8th, 1991. This was the day that the Cold War finally ended after 45 long years, and Boris Yeltsin formed the Commonwealth of Independent States. With a new government came a new ownership structure for Sheremetyevo, officially becoming an independent legal entity as an open joint stock company in 1996. And now to the turn of the century. In 2007, someone in Sheremetyevo's management team decided that Sheremetyevo 1 and 2 sounded like a questionable movie anthology, so the terminals were renamed Terminals A and B. And while they were at it, they thought, why not throw in a Terminal C as well? Terminal C was opened up next to Terminal B, which was previously Sheremetyevo 1. Wait, so Sheremetyevo 1 is Terminal B and Sheremetyevo 2 is Terminal F. Okay, so yeah, it's officially gone from tacky to confusing. Lovely. Anyway, so in 2006, a 2-year-long redevelopment project began on runway number 2. The project saw the runway slightly widened and the concrete layer was now thicker. Shortly after runway 2 was reopened in 2008, a train line was connected to Sheremetyevo, bringing another form of public direct transport between Moscow CBD and the airport. Then in 2009, Sheremetyevo released a master plan for the airport's future development designed to take the airport all the way into 2030. This time, the company contracted for the development plan was Scott & Wilson, who were tasked with creating a new look Sheremetyevo that would be able to handle a capacity of 64 million passengers by the year 2030. And how are they tracking? Well, in 2019, nearly 50 million passengers passed through Sheremetyevo, so with 9 years to go in the plan, I'd say that they're definitely on track. It's now November of 2009, and Sheremetyevo must have some sort of short-term memory loss, because having just completed a new terminal in 2007, they're now finalising the construction of Terminal D, a fourth terminal. The difference this time is that Terminal D is a specially designed hub terminal for Aeroflot, capable of handling 12 million passengers a year. Terminal D's full-scale commercial launch took place at the beginning of 2010, and from 2010 to 2020, so much happened at Sheremetyevo. So much so that just like with Singapore Airport, I'm going to try and list all of them off in quick-fire succession. In 2010, Terminal E was opened. The fifth terminal was now the most technologically advanced at the airport. Construction began on Terminal A, which would be a specialized business aviation terminal. Terminals D, E, and F, and the airport's railway station were all integrated into a new airport sector labeled the Southern Airport Complex. A chapel was also built and opened in Terminal E. In 2011, Putin visited Sheremetyevo and decided that the airfield up the road called Vnukovo would be consumed by Sheremetyevo and that the taxiways would be built to connect the third runway to the airport. Skytrax took notice of how Sheremetyevo was improving, listing the airport in the top 3 for Eastern European airports. Terminal E opened a disability-friendly lounge for passengers with restrictive health conditions. Aeroflot's ownership committee of Terminal D then merged with the ownership committee of Sheremetyevo. In 2012, a transit lounge was opened up in Terminal F. A Sheremetyevo fan club was established. Bit self-indulgent, but I'll allow it. Sheremetyevo could now receive A380 aircraft. They also received the permit to build a new third runway in the place of the Vnukovo site. In 2013, a new fuel storage complex was established at the airport, a new airport control center was opened, a capsule hotel was built at the airport, Sheremetyevo hit a new daily traffic record, and a helipad was opened. In 2014, a new VIP lounge was unveiled in Terminal D, and the airport was proclaimed to be the best airport in Russia, with 48% of the Russian public that was surveyed saying that Sheremetyevo was their airport of choice. The airport then celebrated its 55th anniversary in style by accepting their first A350XWB. Another hotel was then opened at the Southern Airport Complex. Another lounge was also opened in Terminal F. In 2016, Sheremetyevo launched an app, opened three new lounges, a slew of new restaurants and cafes, and appointed a new CEO, Alexander Anatolievich. In 2017, the airport finally got a Macca's. A passenger tunnel was built and completed. The airport's first Starbucks opened in Terminal E. Terminal C was then closed, with the plan being to integrate the new look terminal with the facelifted Terminal B that is already under construction. The largest cargo terminal in Russia was opened and named Moscow Cargo, and the airport's parking area was more than doubled. In 2018, Russia hosted the FIFA World Cup. A new look Terminal B was opened in line with the event, and the third runway was also completed. British Airways established a hub at the airport, and the airport was officially renamed Sheremetyevo Alexander Pushkin Airport in honour of the great Russian poet. In 2019, Skytrax gave Sheremetyevo a 5-star terminal rating. Whew, finally, that brings us up to the current day. So let's summarise what Sheremetyevo looks like today. The airport has 6 passenger terminals, 3 to the south and 3 to the north. It has a large freight terminal facility with dedicated remote aircraft stands. The aerodrome is home to 3 runways, 2 runways in parallel that split the southern terminals from the north, and one that is northeast of the airport with a large taxiway all the way back to the terminals. The airport has a dedicated rail station that feeds into Moscow's rail network, as well as extensive parking facilities in both the north and south precincts. The airport handles 49 million passengers a year and moves about 380,000 tons of freight a year. It's still home to Aeroflot's base of operations, and it is still the main port of entry into the capital of Russia. As for Sheremetyevo's future, well, there'll be more to say on that past 2030, I'd imagine. At current, Sheremetyevo only have the 2009 master plan to bring them into the year 2030. Most of that plan has been completed on schedule, and there's not much in the way of airport additions in the master plan slated out for the next 9 years. What the airport does have, however, is a structure of strategic goals to reach by the end of 2025. Around 50% of these goals are as simple as achieving award-level status in a number of industry areas such as European service quality or flight punctuality, but the other 50% of points focus on the expansion of infrastructure and the optimization of operational efficiency. Some of the major points outlined within these goals include further development of the cargo complex, the reconstruction of Terminal C as per the existing master plan, constructing a new rail station in place of the current one, and essential aerodrome maintenance. Now comes the question of where does Sheremetyevo sit in the fight for environmental conservation and carbon limitation? The answer is this. Sheremetyevo have not created or developed their own independent dedicated initiative for decreasing carbon emissions across their aerodrome. What they have essentially done is that they've approached IATA, taken a look at their environmental regulatory body, and gone copy and paste. To the point where they have not published any documents on the airport's overall impact on its environment or its contribution to carbon emissions. Even its website literally says, "Наша система экологического менеджмента основана на стандарте IATA ISO 14001:2015, что позволяет нам минимизировать негативное воздействие окружающую среду и рационально использовать природные энергетические ресурсы." Gosh, I'm bad at that. So yeah, my rating of their efforts, a 4 out of 10. Still better than O'Hare, which is 1 out of 10. They got a point for using the word environment on the website. That's about it though. And that, my friends, brings you up to date with everything you need to know about Moscow's Sheremetyevo International Airport. Hey, thanks for watching this video. And remember, as always, if you have any suggestions for which airport I should cover next, please leave them down below. I'd love to hear them. If you love this video and you haven't subscribed yet, please do subscribe. It helps my channel a lot. Please like and comment below. As always, I'll see you in the next video and have a great week.